I just want to say one brief word of admiration for this program, which I had nothing to do with building, so I can say this without patting myself on the back. I was asked to just simply have the privilege of emceeing, and really hats off to Georgetown and to the NGA, and also to all of you who have been part of this all day. It's really a remarkable quality of conversation and a great energy in the room and a great level of interest here. So I want to applaud you and thank you for that. Also, you might wonder why an Irishman from Brookings is asked to MC an event that combines NGA and Georgetown. And I guess one of the few positive features of having an Irishman as MC as the afternoon gets closer to 5 o'clock is you at least know we're going to finish it on time because we have other things on our mind. So, but in all seriousness, as I prepare to hand the podium to Suzanne Fry, who's going to speak presumably about the future. We've been hearing a lot about where the future seems to be headed already, but she's got that job as her explicit portfolio. She'll offer some remarks, then she'll join me. I'm going to be away from the microphones. This is the last time you have to tolerate me near a hot mic all day. You can be reassured. But then we'll just do a quick Q&A. I'll call on a few people, and then she'll respond. Then we'll depart and hand the podium to Bruce Hoffman, who will close the whole event in about a half hour. So without further ado, I hope Suzanne Fry is near me and ready to speak.
Behind you.
Wonderful.
Right behind you. Thank you so much. So I, first of all, congratulations to all of you for sticking it out for the final presentation this afternoon. I know I appreciate that you're still here and smiling and enthusiastic. So what a great opportunity to be able to visit as national security professionals and scholars and practitioners to get together and kind of trade notes on where we see the profession going. As Michael indicated, I'm from the National Intelligence Council, which I'm sure most of you are familiar with. It is charged with essentially integrating the strategic analysis of the now 17 different agencies of the U.S. intelligence community. It's also charged with doing very extensive policy support at PC and DC meetings in the foreign policy making process. And then we do this last thing that's called outreach, which is sort of a term of art within our community. But really it's about getting out in the world in an overt manner and basically learning from professionals and frankly from people who of all walks of life really. And what I'm about to do is to share with you one project where we combine all three missions of the NIC. It's called Global Trends. It's publicly available. The NIC, actually started by CIA in 1996, has now been doing this for more than 20 years. So for every incoming year of a U.S. presidency, we offer the Global Trends publication. So it's a strategic assessment of the future to come, the key trends and uncertainties shaping the strategic landscape that will confront a returning or incoming U.S. administration. And what I'm going to do today is kind of walk you through the high points of that assessment, which we delivered in January of this year, and it's called Global Trends, the Paradox of Progress. There's a little handout outside that summarizes the key trends and subsequent judgments in the report, because I'm not going to be able to go through everything in detail. But what I'm hoping today that I can provide you is a bit of a framework on which to hang some of today's conversation. Now, where does big data fit in all this? How do I scale terrorism vis-a-vis geopolitical competition? What are the underlying trends that are actually making these issues come to the fore? And so our effort in the Global Trends publication is to actually develop such a framework. It may be, we hope it is, terribly accurate and insightful most of the time. We're not kidding ourselves. We know that we would probably have made all sorts of errors in it. But we have a point of view with the document and a perspective and one that we think that is very well evidenced and reasoned. And we think that having such a perspective is useful for our policy masters who use a document like this to formulate strategy. So think about global trends as the assessment of the strategic landscape, the security environment to come, on which our policy planners and strategists then build strategy, right, to advance American interests, if you will. So one of the awesome privileges of my job is to be able to undertake this project, and it's an incredibly humbling exercise. It is essentially working with others around the world, within our community as well, to understand our shared past, our shared present, such that we can make sense and anticipate the future. And we do not do this in a vacuum. We do this with other people. And this is very important for those of you who are going into national security professions to understand the ability to communicate and to collaborate and to lead others in doing two of those, both of those two things. And so for me, this was a real treat and to be able to sort of stretch those legs in this project. But the way we did this project is we essentially met with people from all walks of life. To be exact, 2,500 different people in 35 countries plus the Palestinian Authority over the course of 2.5 years. We coupled those conversations, which were essentially about, tell me about your expectations for your government, about expectations of the United States. How do you think your children's lives are going to unfold? What are you most optimistic about? What are you most fearful about? These types of conversations give us insight as to how people will likely make decisions when confronted with certain, the convergence of certain trends, if you will. This is not necessarily something that's supposed to be scientific, about an opinion study, or something like that. It's much more subtle than that. It is about giving us an insight into the decision-making of people in very specific circumstances, which then comes back into play later on in our analysis. We couple that type of information with, of course, the best of academic research. We commission a ton of studies, including some from Professor Yost here, who I've recognized in the front row, who has actually had my job before me and has returned here to Georgetown and helped us out very much on the assessments of the future of the United States for this project. So you can blame Kaz for whatever faults we may have made there. So anyhow, a tremendous honor and privilege to be able to undertake this type of analysis. So let me tell you what we learned. Our story of the future begins and ends with a paradox. Life has gotten better in many ways for many people in many places, and yet the world feels darker and more uncertain, and perhaps than ever for some. And so what we're recognizing here is this paradoxical moment. So the progress of the last several decades is historic, and it is very important to recognize these achievements, the achievements of the industrial and information ages that have connected people in ways that were once unthought of, have empowered individuals, groups in smaller states to act in ways that are geopolitically consequential, and have lifted 1 billion people out of poverty in 2 decades. And grant, it's arguable whether that's 4 decades or 2 decades, but 1989 to 2011, we see 1 billion people lifted out of poverty. 600 million alone are in China. Absolutely transformational and historic achievements. But the same progress that I've just walked through has spawned shocks like the Arab Spring, the 2008 financial crisis, and the global rise of populist anti-establishment movements. There are all sorts of other shocks that have also been unleashed as well, and the environmental ones and technological ones are very important to keep our eyes on. But these shocks illustrate for us just how fragile the progress of these past achievements have been, and it underscores some very deep shifts that are going on in the global landscape, as well as the importance of the quality of the political decisions that are being made now about the future. And so what I'd like to do now is kind of walk you through a couple of these more significant shifts in an effort to give you that framework or heuristic in which to hang today's conversation. And then to conclude our discussion with some thoughts about how can our systems become, and specifically our national security and intelligence systems, become more resilient and robust and actually thrive in this era of volatility and uncertainty moving forward. So first, what did we find in terms of when you open the Global Trends report and you sit down and read it, the storyline is as follows. Recent and future trends are converging to proliferate the number of actors and issues and to fracture the information environment. In turn, those developments are making it much more difficult for governments to govern and to cooperate with one another, putting a premium on the quality of policy choices as well as efforts or investments into resilience in order to manage shocks for the future. So that's basically the arc of the story of this Global Trends edition. This is distinct from other global trends, which frankly did not have a narrative taking you through the report, and which is what we've tried to do this time around. And so the report then details a series of trends broken down into 7 different ones. I'm just gonna highlight a couple of them for you. lots of folks really get very excited about the trends analysis. I'm not one of them. I'm more interested in the implications of the trends, so I'm going to zip ahead on that. But some of the more important trends to keep your eye on is that the global economy is shifting before our eyes, and we are entering and have been in a period of what we believe to be lower rates of economic growth, which are really putting quite a bit of pressure, political pressure, on governments in advanced industrial societies. So the expectations that citizens have in terms of well-being, in terms of meaningful employment moving forward, are actually becoming much more difficult in this slower growth environment. There are lots of subordinate reasons for that, one of which is the growing preponderance of investment in technology as opposed to labor. So the returns on technology are outpacing those from labor. And of course, this is resulting in some really, frankly, frustrated publics. And so the political economy story that I just laid out for you here is very important in this global trends, trying to understand the governance challenges moving forward. The other key trend I want to highlight for you concerns the changing nature of warfare. We like to say that warfare is evolving in ways that it's becoming more diverse, more diffuse, and more disruptive. More diverse in the sense that the means of warfare, the technology of warfare, is quite literally diversifying from very primitive, crude, familiar means to very sophisticated means that actually some of which don't really require state institutions anymore to develop. A scientist, you think about synthetic biology or biotechnologies, these are capabilities that are in the hands of individuals, right? That changes the game quite a bit. Warfare becoming more diffuse in the sense that the actors themselves are proliferating. State and non-state, yes, but the range of the diversity within them is also expanding. And then finally, disruptive. This is one of the key points to really take away from the current and emerging era, is that adversaries, whether state or non-state right now, are very much focusing on their ability and undertaking it to disrupt societies. So attacking societies as opposed to combatant organizations. So if you think about Russian activities towards the United States, Russian activities in Ukraine, so-called little green men in Ukraine, trying to keep, so competing in ways that may not be kinetic, may not be certainly well below the threshold of overt hostility and active warfare, but are nonetheless able to achieve Russian interests at the expense of their opponent's interests, able to block the United States. And in the instance of the United States in the last year, able to distort, frankly, the citizens' relationship with government and the electoral process. So this is victory without having to have the costs of a battlefield. And so it's very important that we wrap our heads around what the future battle space will look like and to recognize that it is not a frankly now almost quaint sort of 18th century perception of warfare where we have recognized combatant organizations engaging in conflict, violent conflict, but yet we see the whole spectrum of warfare using different tools, different domains of activity. So those two trends I really want to highlight for you in terms of the economic growth and the changing nature of warfare. I told you at the beginning of my talk is that these trends are coming together in ways to make it harder to govern and to cooperate internationally. I want to unpack that a little bit more. The technological, environmental, demographic trends are increasing the number of issues, the complexity of issues, and the speed at which they are confronting governance. That's the first thing to pay attention to, the first implication of the convergence of trends. The second is that economic development and growing military capabilities are increasing the number of states that are able to compete geopolitically. Just a few years ago, 5 years ago, you might have thought about maybe 20 different states in the world system that were able to prevent the United States or pause the United States in its actions. That number is increasing. The poster child of this is, of course, we now talk about China in a very consequential way, almost in a peer competitor way. There's some debate as to whether or not China has actually reached that status. But the bottom line is that we see more states able to compete in ways that only a handful used to. The third key implication of the convergence of trends really concerns the convergence of information technologies, so smartphone capabilities, having a computer in your pocket, combined with economic development trends. The reduction of poverty for the nearly billion people of the world means that they are no longer simply trying to survive, but they exercise influence as consumers and political actors and otherwise. You bring that technology together with that ability to have influenced, their mind is occupied on things other than survival. And you have now individuals as consequential political actors. We talked a little bit in the preceding session about the Tunisian fruit vendor. Fruit vendors were not geopolitically consequential for most of human history. Some of them now are in the right circumstances because of the convergence of these trends. The final implication of trend convergence I want to highlight for you is the fragmenting of the information environment. Again, this is due to technology, but it's also in commerce, and certainly major information companies creating tools that are of convenience to us. They're life-changing, they're wonderful and fantastic, but at the same time, there are commercial imperatives behind that have some distorting implications. You pair that with actors who deliberately seek to manipulate publics, often through identity politics, and you very clearly get a fracturing of the information environment. Well, why does this matter? This is a big deal for democracies, because with multiple, frankly, fractured views, separate realities, it makes it very difficult to come together in terms of consensus about what the problems are, let alone what the solutions are. And so our wonderful, great democracy, this deliberative democracy here just down the road in the Congress, the fact that we cannot come together, the fact that political polarization is as deep as it is not an accident that that is taking place simultaneously as the advent of these technologies and the rise of identity politics, which gets a lot of play during periods of economic difficulty, which we have been living through for the last 10 years coming out of the financial crisis. So those four implications of the convergence of trends are very important to the NIC in this particular assessment, because it explains to us why instability dynamics or governance within countries has not gotten any easier, in fact, has gotten much harder. It also explains to us why international cooperation between states is becoming more difficult. And for that, I want to kind of turn a little bit away from concept and towards reality as we see it in the next 5 years. So looking forward, we see these trends essentially manifesting in more difficult domestic politics within countries worldwide. So my background is in instability and governance work, and I used to spend most of my time worried about two-thirds of the planet and which of those countries was likely to have an instability outbreak. At this point, I can't really sit in that job and that role anymore and only limit it to the two-thirds of the planet. We have to think about how dysfunctions in governance, the inability to compromise, is actually weakening advanced industrial democracies. And so this is very much on our minds. And as tensions within these societies grow, we're also seeing at the same time increasing tensions between countries. And there's a very specific set of historic and structural reasons for why geopolitical competition is increasing right at this moment. Yes, we have a rising China. Yes, we have a Russia that is trying to reassert its relevance in the world stage. But we also have a West that is inward and preoccupied with its own fiscal challenges. So that political polarization that I talked about that prevented governments in the West from dealing with their fiscal challenges, which are profound because of some demographic issues, prior entitlement commitments, defense spending that for us in the United States is also a non-negotiable. We have an inward West, and Russia and China especially, seeking to take advantage of this particular moment. So we see a relationship with geopolitical competition and internal politics in a way that we think these two are inseparable at this point. And it's not about a theory of diversionary war. It's not about the interrelationship between these two things. It's really about the health of the polities themselves and whether or not that constitution enables countries to lead and be engaged in the world, or if it allows them to take advantage and exploit in the world. And so we're seeing some political openings for China and Russia especially to take advantage of. But their way of doing so, they're seeking to do so in ways that stay below the threshold of certainly of overt war, but they're using means and techniques that frankly are very dangerous and prone to miscalculation. And so this is why in the report we judge that the next few years especially will see a greater risk of interstate conflict than certainly anything we've seen since the end of the Cold War, and it's probably much more akin to the risk levels that were observed during the Cold War. So I've talked a lot about China and Russia there, but we also have regional aggressors that are exploiting this moment too. And then finally, your previous sessions have spent a lot of time thinking about the expanding nature of terrorism, and our assessment tracks very nicely, particularly with Bruce Riedel's observations earlier. The fourth thing about the next 5 years, and frankly this goes on not just to the next 20 years, but will be ever present with us, are risks of significant discontinuity due to environmental or natural phenomenon, as well as technological phenomenon. Just picking a news story out of the last 24 hours, this horrible story of the nursing home in Florida where the eight people succumbed. So here we have a convergence of a growing elderly population, an infrastructure that's really not prepared for that population, and we have systems that are not resilient to environmental shock coming together in a moment, creating a discontinuity, creating a problem. That's now a political problem. And so the future will, kind of envision things like that happening again and again. Now, excuse me, more distant futures. Now that was kind of bleak, although that was kind of a rosy version of my bleak. I can go much darker, trust me, much. More distant futures for the NIC depend upon three key uncertainties in the political, personal, and economic choices around the following three questions, which we explore in terms of some scenarios. The first question for us, and we're staking a bet and saying these three questions are the most important for understanding the next 20 years. The first question is the following. Will global economic integration persist should we see a prolonged period of low economic growth? Will we continue to see a deepening of globalization? If we don't, if we see a stalling or even a reversal of globalization, what then are the implications for economic development within countries, all countries, in terms of advanced industrial, in terms of developing countries today? The development model that has been on the table for wealth creation of the last half century, at least, really does require global economic integration, a global value chain. Being able to provide low-cost labor, low-cost goods and services into that value chain in order to create wealth and then investment and so forth to climb that value chain. Well, what happens if that isn't there anymore? That's the developing world. So that amazing progress we've seen in terms of the reduction of poverty in the world could very much be threatened by this the politics that we're seeing unfold right now with respect to whether or not to further deepen economic integration. So that's the first key uncertainty. The second key uncertainty concerns the health, if you will, or the future of international order, and by that I mean that post-1945 system of rules and practices born out of World War II that has amazingly succeeded in terms of preventing major power conflict and creating a suite of financial and economic institutions to create that development I just spoke about. What happens if the geopolitical competition we're observing to date basically trashes that set of rules and institutions or weakens them such that they're no longer meaningful? And we're already beginning to see early indications of that. I'm glad to talk about that later. So that's the second key uncertainty. What replaces that? Does it get refined? Do we actually end up in a spheres of influence world, which is where we judge things are trending right now in terms of regional dominance by major states? And sort of this a la carte cooperation where you can get it. So cooperation on soft global issues, but when it comes to real hard security issues, it will be the regional power that asserts its influence. Third final uncertainty is about the creation of order, of governance, and whether or not there are other ways of doing it. We're seeing that governments today are being overwhelmed. The best performing governments are actually at the lowest level of government, local mayors, if you will, counties, and so forth. It's a much more manageable problem with a smaller population to deal with. We're also seeing innovation in governance with respect to private-public partnerships. So the question for us is, will we get to a point where major states actually cede some of the formal responsibilities of government to other providers? And so this is kind of a very interesting scenario, both in a positive sense as well as a negative sense. There's a caliphate version of this, and then there's your homeowners association version of this. And for some people, those are the same thing. But anyhow, so those are the three uncertainties moving forward. Quality of the global economy, the nature of it, whether or not the sort of rules of the road of international and geopolitical competition will endure or be altered, and then the future of how order gets created. When I gave this talk to Director Brennan and Director Clapper about a year ago now, very dark, and they said, "Susie, you guys have spent a lot of time going through all of this research, meeting with people around the world. Surely you've found some opportunities. Surely you have found some ways out of this sort of circling the drain dynamic that you've observed with these trend lines." And so it prompted us to step back and think, well, what are the ingredients of organizations and individuals that not just survive volatile, uncertain environments, but thrive in those environments? And what I'd like for you to do today is think about the following observations in terms of the future of the intelligence community, the future of the national security profession. And we said to ourselves after that reflection, all right, what makes for resilience? And we came up with three things. Investments in infrastructure, yes, physical hard infrastructure, but also human infrastructure, the ability to retool, the ability to have the type of critical thinking skills that are relevant irrespective of the technology space that we might be in, and also natural or environmental infrastructure. Is our lived and environmental, our ecology, if you will, is it resilient to, frankly, the stuff we're gonna do to it and have done to it? Are there different ways that we can treat that environment such that it will continue to nurture and support us rather than the opposite? So that's the first type of investment in infrastructure for more resilient systems. The second type of investment is an investment in knowledge. And this is meant in two ways. One, in a very practical, concrete way, in the cyber age, we talked about the credit company this week, the big scandal. That happening. So cyber attacks on private industries and our data and privacy being violated. So yes, hardening corporations and government data, that's one piece of it. But there's also another piece of it, which is equipping our citizenry to be able to make sense of news stories that may not be true. Equipping our citizenry to challenge and hold elites and public officials accountable in ways that are constructive and meaningful. And so really paying attention to how we treat knowledge here and information in that space. Data integrity is another piece of this as well. And then the final type of investment that we think is important to make, and you guys spent a whole panel talking about this today, are investments in relationships. So the mess of issues is so profound, so complex, all over the place, that it's impossible for any one organization or state to be able to manage this. So we have to think about who we might be able to partner with. And in the national security community, we're very familiar with Five Eyes. Well, okay, maybe the Northern Europeans, perhaps the Japanese. And so it's all state-based. And of course, we've got some histories and common interests and values across those entities. But the world that we're entering into is going to require partnerships that go far beyond that sort of state-to-state. It's going to require, you know, public to private, So across domain type partnerships, but also partnerships that are straddle different levels of hierarchy from the elite level down to local levels. And so we would encourage those of you out there thinking about the future of diplomacy, if you will, or the future of development, or the future of intelligence, about who your partners need to be when both local granular information is very, very important when we are in the era of empowered individuals, but also significant sort of information and scientific breakthroughs are absolutely needed to understand the world that we're entering into. So with that, I will wrap up. I'm a little long here, but thanks for your time and attention and not running to the bar once Michael put that in your head.
So. Thank you very much, Suzanne. I think what we'll do in the interest of me keeping my earlier promise is just to have one round of two brief questions if we could, and then we'll let Suzanne speak to that, and then we'll defer to Bruce to wrap things up for the day. So if there are one or two questions, we'll see if we can just combine them into a single round. Where were you pointing, sir? I'm sorry. Okay, so we've got one in the back, and then we'll come up here to the second row for a second brief question, please.
Hi, ma'am. Brandon Corbin from SSP. Given all the changes, in addition to looking at new partners for intelligence cooperation, how might the IC change structurally, and what would Nick's role be in that?
It's like catnip to ask a question like
that.
Do
you want to take the other
questions? Go ahead. Yeah, let's do that.
So it's way up here in the second row. If you can come on up, and we'll see if. Second brief question, please.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks for your presentation. I'm kind of bothered, like, intelligence, or actually how to call it, the big data. I just wonder if we can just use the existing data, try to solve a social problem that will be more meaningful. Like now we have GOP or Democrat, they have ideology, but they don't even know what they are. But now we have racial profiling, we have police killing. If you can get those data together and get the people's voice together, get the people's complaint together. Now we have improper processing of complaint, processing, proceedings, records, everything is wrong. So we must go from the basics, try to collect all those data rather than think about the big data go beyond other nations.
Okay,
sure,
thank you.
Great.
Over to you.
Okay, so a question on intelligence reform, and I'm going to stick close to what I know best, which is the analytic part of the U.S. intelligence community. There's a, you know, we learn and overlearn. So we learn, we lurch from one intelligence failure and then the subsequent reforms, one from another. And right now we're basically in the tailwinds of, if you will, the post WMD commission, where in that instance, and the 9/11 commission, I'm going to kind of put the lessons from both of those on the table. Both of those very strongly came down, and rightly so, came down on tradecraft associated with treatment of evidence. And that there shall be evidence. Amen. Yes, we need evidence. There should always be evidence. But we overlearned that a little bit in the sense that we went too far in the direction of needing to have a source for every single judgment. That essentially, if you look at publications like the PDB or any of the other daily intelligence pubs, probably half, and I'm being really generous there, it's probably a lot more than that, at least half of the pieces are pure gisting and reporting. It is not analysis. And so analysts are a little gun-shy on being forward-leaning and deriving inferences from a body of evidence. And so what I'd like to see moving forward, if I were queen for a day and could magically transform the IC, is to get us to a place where strategic analysis was not simply, I'm paid to do strategic analysis, but I am not incentivized to do it. I am not. And my team and analysts who work with me face so many other challenges that take them away from attention on the ability to provide the deep thinking, the ability to do multidisciplinary analysis, the ability to step outside of the policy process for a little bit in order to think about, well, what to challenge assumptions and so forth. So if I were Queen, I'm rambling a little bit here, but I really want us to focus on the fact that analysis is much more than simply the gisting of reporting, but it is creating new insight. And the way we do that, in my view, is that we're forward-looking in our assessments. We're multidisciplinary. We put an issue in a 360-degree context. And in a case like Global Trends, what we've done there is, yes, we've articulated the strategic landscape, the context to come,
But we've also had a keen eye on the various actors that are in that context. So whether they're adversaries or they're allies, they're states or non-states, some of those are compatible with American interests and others are not. Good, high-quality strategic analysis gives us insights about how to shape those conditions. It is not gisting of reporting. So if I were queen for a day, I would, and I could really be very specific here about it, but I will refrain from doing so because this is being recorded. But I think that overlearning of some of those past lessons has gotten us to a place where we're not as useful as perhaps we could be. And then the question about big data and the types of information that are available. I think the reality is that information has always been exponential and has always been overwhelming. It's perhaps more so now because of new technologies. That does not take us off the hook from treating that information properly. And so abuses of information or basically a manipulation of information, that's not analysis. That's a political act, and that's not the business that I'm in, and that's not the business that a lot of national security professionals are in. So what I'm heartened by that within the analytic community and the broader IC writ large is there is a very rigorous and careful treatment of information, is never to abuse it and misuse it in the way that we might see played out on television and in the theater of politics, which is a very different exercise than what we're doing in terms of trying to assess the strategic environment, friends, foes, and how to advance American interests. So I'm not as concerned about that within my community.
Please join me again. Thank you, Suzanne.
Well, it remains for me to conclude, and at the end of a very long day with very rich and informative discussions, which is a very diplomatic way of saying everyone who wants to go get coffee or go to the bar. So, let me thank all of you firstly for coming, both from NGA, from the Security Studies Program, from Georgetown College, and from Georgetown School of Foreign Service. I mean, we do these events for all of you, so if you weren't interested and if you weren't engaged, they wouldn't have been a success, and the questions were all fantastic. In terms of thanks, first and foremost, we have to acknowledge the many kindnesses and immense generosity of Tom Kalaris and his family. Many years ago, about a decade ago, in fact, Tom came to Georgetown and said that he wanted to create an endowment that would honor his father, George T. Kalaris, who this conference is named after, who was one of the unsung heroes of the Cold War. And we took Mr. Kalaris's desires very seriously, and thus we formed this partnership with NGA for the second very successful intelligence conference. We've had conferences that the Kalarises have been involved in, covering the legacy of James Angleton, counter-radicalization and counter-terrorism, the future of terrorism, advice for the incoming administration on counter-terrorism policy. So that funding, I think, has been enormously important in doing exactly what Tom Kalaris intended it to do, was to sort of bridge the chasm that often separated academe from government or academe from the intelligence community. And it's also actually resulted in very practical and often policy-driven solutions, or at least recommendations, being provided as a result of these conferences. So our debt to Tom and the Kalaris family is enormous, and our honor and privilege to carry on the traditions that George T. Kalaris pioneered as in the Central Intelligence Agency during his long and storied career is both a great honor and a pleasure for us. Director Robert Cardillo, who in fact is an alum of what was then the National Security Studies Program, is now the Security Studies Program, has been the best possible partner. And especially that discussion this morning between himself and Eric Schmidt was really priceless. I mean, this is why people come to the Security Studies Program at Georgetown and why they work at NGA as well, because it's where you can have that kind of an intimate, frank discussion in a setting conducive to the give and take and back and forth of question and answer and probing. Certainly the panels on big data, intelligence sharing, and counterterrorism hit on all the key issues that confront US policymakers and face the intelligence community on a daily basis. Again, too, having the opportunity for Michael O'Hanlon to sit down with Bruce Rydell, who's a paragon and whose CV reads like a history of intelligence operations and policy challenges of the late 20th century and early 21st century, was really priceless, as was Suzanne Fry's closing keynote address. So I'd like to thank the people from the NGA, the volunteers who staff this event, and also especially Connie Heiss, who orchestrated this and was the best possible partner in arranging the conference. The security studies team, especially of Jordan Mooney, who's responsible for SSP outreach and conference activities. These are labor-intensive events that require months of planning, and Jordan worked extremely effectively with Connie and the rest of the NGA team, I think, to produce what was a highly successful conference. She was supported by Peyton Tanner of the SSP staff, David Maxwell, the associate director, General James Dubik, our director of external education, who's responsible for the academic side of outreach, and Professor Elizabeth Grimm Arsenault, who is our director of teaching and also oversees our intelligence concentration. We're also indebted to, even though he's not here, Nate Green, from the School of Foreign Service Careers Office, who organized and led the Careers Fair, which we've held in tandem with the conference, and then also the moderators who probed and interviewed the panelists and Director Cardillo, and also all the speakers. We couldn't have done better having Michael O'Hanlon as the master of ceremonies. That is an enormously difficult job that requires a lot of prep, being involved in all aspects of the actual implementation of the conference, and we're really indebted to Michael for taking a full day out from his own busy schedule to be here. And then finally, to again cite the magnificent help we had both from the NGA volunteers and also from the students from the Security Studies program, who volunteered as ushers, as guides, in all manner of assistance in making the conference possible. So finally, thank you all also for coming once again, and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.